Recorded Books presents Rune Seeker, Book 2, by J.M. Clarke and C.J. Thompson. Narrated by Ralph Lister. Chapter 1. Welcome to the Asylum. Hiral sat back and rolled his shoulders, upper body stiff from how he'd been hunched over the workbench, but couldn't help but smile at the progress. The shattered stuff he'd gotten as the dungeon reward from the troubling throne sat organized and sorted back to a semblance of its former shape. Using the flowing script inscribed within the crystal itself, he'd been able to carefully align the hundreds of broken shards until they formed a flat ring almost 2.5 feet in diameter. "Still no idea what you'd do," he said to the ring quietly, fingers practically itching to start using his mold crystal ability to mend the seams. Considering he'd gotten the item for basically soloing the zone-capping dungeon, it had to be good, whatever it was. But... Hiral's eyes drifted up from the bench to the red glow of the asylum central room, just beyond the workshop door. They'd arrived there just around 20 years ago, to be met with Dr. Benz's shocking proclamation.
"If you're seeing this version of me, it can only mean one thing. The magic keeping Fallen Reach in the sky is failing,"
Dr. Benz's tired image had said.
"You need to act. You need to save it. If you don't, within 1 year, the island and everybody on it will be destroyed."
Then, before anybody even had a moment to really digest the words, he'd continued.
"Accessing PIMs. Access complete. PIMs of suitable power to achieve necessary results not detected. Failure calculated at 98.3%. Shutting down external access to run crisis response scenarios. External access to be restored in approximately 24 hours.
Dr. Benzer had then vanished without another word, leaving the entry room with its ominous blood-red glow, the interface unresponsive to the party. Maybe, in a way, that had been for the best. Considering everything that had happened, the deaths of 4 friends and the loss of Piccoli, the group needed a rest. The Fallen Reach crisis wasn't something they could do anything about immediately anyway. So the forced 24 hours of downtime after so long on the run? Not a bad thing. Needing to stretch his legs, Hiral got up and began to slowly pace around the central workbench. As he did, his fingers traced along the tabletop while his mind replayed the events that had brought him there. The first long edge of the table was like his time without a class, his time on Fallen Reach as the Everfail. It made sense it was the longest part of the table. It had been the longest part of his life after all. But still, that wasn't who he was. Yes, it had shaped him. No, it didn't define him. He reached the corner, which represented when he'd jumped off the Grower's Island. Twice. 2 jumps and 1 turning point that had brought him to the surface with Sina, Nivian, Yanali, Wool, and Vix. Hiral's steps faltered slightly as Vix crossed his mind, but he pushed it aside. That part of the journey was further down the table. For now, this short end of the table represented those first chaotic hours on the surface. The search for Sina's sister, Ciela, and her party. The run-in with the Shapers from Fallen Reach, who'd captured and planned to kill the Growers. And most importantly, at the next turning point, the next corner of the table, he's getting a class. Never in a million rotations, or years as Dr. Benzer preferred to call them, would he have predicted the crystal monster that had chased them, gifting him a class. But it had, and his entire world had changed. That led him to the next long section of the table, representing the first part of their time stranded on the surface. With their way back blocked by the Shapers, they'd done the only thing they could. returned to the dungeon. What followed were arguably some of the best times in Hiral's life, despite the circumstances. Challenge. Growth. Friends. Real friends. Oh, and his doubles, left and right. Hiral shook his head a bit at that. It was surreal, literally talking to two different versions of himself, complete with their own abilities, thoughts, and personalities. It was also enlightening and brutally honest. His fingers continued along the table as memories of their battles in the first two dungeons, Troblin Keep and the Mire, played out in his head. The Troblin bosses, the summoning ritual, the butcher, and finally the eloquent Duke, had been a literal trial by fire, packed with explosive growth. The runic hand cannons he'd gotten there, along with the experience using his new runes, had led to his evolved fighting style. In the Mire, the King and Queen of the Swamp, the scholarly Sealer, and finally the monstrous Hydra, the Prince of the Swamp, had forced the party to work together like never before to survive, to thrive. His reward for surviving that dungeon had been the legendary S-rank Emperor's Greatsword, and his eyes went to where the broken blade rested on another nearby table. He still had a quest to repair it, but even in its current state, it was fearsomely powerful. All in all, things had been going pretty well, until he got to the next corner of the table. The corner where everything changed. It was then that the enemy had found them. The thing Dr. Benzer had warned them about. He turned the corner slowly, and in the short edge of the table, Hiral relived watching his friends die. Lonil, the tank, smashed into the ground. Vix, his party mate and friend, yanked into the dark night sky. Piccoli, possessed by the enemy, and her fist through Balio's chest. Even Fitch, asshole that he was gone. After they'd barely escaped the carnage with their lives, Hiral had somehow managed to solo the third and final dungeon of the area, the Troblin Throne. That had opened the path to the asylum. It was a success that would have been celebrated any other time. Still, so many lost in such a short time, and Hiral lifted his hand from the table before he got to the next corner. What would come after the next big change when the asylum interface unlocked? Not something I'll find an answer to, walking circles around a table by myself, Hiral muttered, taking one look at the shattered ring on the table, then spinning on his heel and exiting the workshop. After the initial shock of Dr. Benzer's words, the party had mainly dragged themselves to one of the beds in the dormitory area and then collapsed into unconsciousness. With left and right keeping watch just in case, they'd slept for hours. Hiral hadn't been the first to awaken. He'd found Sina and Ciela out in the living area chatting quietly, but it had looked like they needed time. So he'd given it to them, going to explore the multi-tiered training room and then losing himself in fixing the crystal ring in the workshop. Now it was time to see how the others were doing. Following the rhythmic thunking of metal on wood, Hiral peeked into the kitchen first. "Hey," he said, spotting Nivian in a floral apron behind the counter, a mountain of chopped vegetables beside him. "What you making?"
"Hey, Hiral."
"Stew," Nivian said, looking up while still chopping.
"Figured we could use something a bit more wholesome than rations. The pantry is fully stocked, and the garden over there..."
He nodded his head in the direction of another door.
"It's surprisingly extensive. I think there's even a section further for small animals like rabbits."
"Are they covered in spikes or elites?" Hiral asked with a chuckle.
"Not the one I saw," the tank said. "Though I didn't view it, so it might be elite. Wouldn't that just be something? A killer rabbit in here with us."
Dr. Benzer seemed like he was kind of a sadist, so I wouldn't be surprised,
Hiral said. Do you need any help with dinner?
Just need you to keep left and right out of here,
Nivian said, actually stopping the knife to point at Hiral.
If I hear one more comment about needing more salt...
Whoa, got it. Hiral held his hands up and patted the air. Where are they anyway?
Think I saw them in the training room with Yanali,
Nivian said, the knife blurring back to activity. You sure you don't need some help? Hiral asked once more. The knife slowed, then picked up speed again as Nivian shook his head.
I think I just need the time to myself, if you don't mind, he said, his voice low.
Hiral opened his mouth to tell the tank it wasn't his fault, the others had died. That he couldn't protect everybody all the time. But between Nivian's slumped shoulders and too firm grip on the carrot, Hiral sensed the words would only do more harm than good. Well, let me at least do the dishes then, he said instead.
Deal. I hate dishes,
Nivian said without looking up, and Hiral left the kitchen silently.
He's still cutting vegetables,
a voice asked as Hiral entered the blood-red interface room. He'd been at it long, Hiral asked, when he spotted Nivian's twin brother, Wool, leaning against the entrance to the living area with a book in his hand.
Almost as long as you were nose deep in that crystal stuff in the workshop, Wool said. You make any progress?
Just about ready to put it back together, assuming my mold crystal ability works, Hiral said, walking over to join Wool.
Nivian going to be okay?
Give him time. He's taking it pretty hard.
Who am I kidding? We all are. Lonil was kind of a role model for Nivian, though. And after he'd promised to take care of everybody...
Wool trailed off.
Can we not talk about it, though? I picked up a book to try and forget some of that.
Sure. What did you find? Anything good?
Steamy romance.
Wool said, sliding a finger into the collar of his shirt and pulling it away from his neck a few times, like he was trying to cool off.
Don't expect me to get anything productive done until I finish it.
Just picture them all as troblins, Hiral said, and Wool visibly blanched.
And I'm done, he said, the book clapping shut. Thank you very much. That painting still haunts my dreams, you know.
Sorry. Couldn't help myself, Hiral said.
Yeah. And I'll remember it the next time you need a heal,
Wool grumbled before stomping back into the living area.
Oh, come on. It's not that bad,
Hiral called after him.
Whatever,
Wool said, tossing the book onto one of the couches. Sina and Ciela glanced up at him, though their faces still looked serious. Hiral gave the two sisters a wave when they saw him, but it didn't look like they were ready for company yet. So he waved a second time and then went into the training room.
To jump higher,
Left was saying as Hiral walked in. Yanali stood in front of the double with his spear point driven into the floor, Right hanging back a few steps.
I'm jumping as high as I can,
Yanali said, lifting his spear up from the unmarked floor. The surfaces of the training room had proven to be extremely durable when Hiral had been in there earlier.
Right, just moved too quickly. Oh, I should just stand still while you bunny hop,
Right asked.
It wasn't a bunny hop,
Yanali said, his hand slowly spinning his spear in his dancing spear style.
It was majestic. And fearsome.
Bunnies can be fearsome and majestic, Hiral said, walking over to join the three. Just ask Nivian about the boss level one in the kitchen, he added, thumbing back over his shoulder.
There's a boss bunny in the kitchen? Think it's worth much experience?
Yanali asked, the spear whipping around his back in a tight spin, like it was second nature. Not that you could hit it with your bunny hop, Right said.
Not a bunny hop, Yanali snapped again.
Should I ask? Hiral said.
Yanali is working on a new ability, Wright said. A new move? It's not an actual ability.
Need any help with it? Hiral asked.
Oh, yes. A third one of you critiquing me will definitely help, Yanali said dryly.
I'm a little more balanced than these two, Hiral said, giving his doubles a small glare.
What do you try to accomplish?
Yanali twisted away, his feet moving smoothly across the floor in a dance akin to the namesake of his spear style, then dropped into a fighting stance with the spear held in front of him.
The last dungeon and the things that happened before that, they showed me a lot of my weaknesses. When I had...
He gulped, then forced the words out of his mouth.
When I had Vix opposite me, we played off each other, moving fast to keep our opponents off balance. We also never fought anything really strong. But then, against the Troblin Lord and Piccoli, I hardly did anything. I couldn't punch through the Lord's armor, and you saw Piccoli move around me like I wasn't even there. Getting better with Dancing Spear style will help with that second one. But I need something like what Balio had. A one-hit, big damage move.
And that's what you're working on, Hiral asked.
Something you're trying to create instead of an ability you got from an achievement reward.
Yeah, Yanali said, his spear thrusting up rapid fire like the shaft was made of rubber or a giant reed. I'm hoping for a spontaneous ability evolution or, you know, maybe just doing it like you do. Through practice.
Can you show me? I might have some pointers.
Sure. You know my reed spear style, Yanali said, continuing the rapid thrusting. I'll keep using it for straight-on fights, but what I want to do is...
He trailed off as the spear went from thrusting back to spinning around him in wide arcs. Sweep right, left, around his back, and then his feet moved in as the spear's blade whipped down, then up, in a powerful uppercut. More than that, Yanali leapt into the air as his blade went up, letting the momentum of the swing carry him until at the apex of his jump, he spun the blade around again to drive it point first into the ground as he landed.
That, he finished.
I see, Hiral said, replaying the maneuver in his head.
Which part do you want to be the big hit? The thrust from the sky, Yanali said.
Sky is pretty low these days, Wright mumbled, and Hiral shot him another glare.
The uppercut part was really well done, Hiral said, but I hate to say it, for the final part to pack enough punch, you need more than a bunny hop, Left said. I was going to say height, Hiral said, tapping his lip in thought. If you had the runes of rejection and attraction, don't have your abilities, Yanali pointed out. No, but I have an idea about how I can maybe loan them to you, so to speak, Hiral said. Let me work on it and get back to you.
Really?
Yanali asked, his eyes practically lighting up.
Yeah, just don't get your hopes up until we see if it works, Hiral said. That may have to wait, Left said seriously, and Hiral turned to his double, who was facing out of the training room.
Hiral followed the other's gaze to find the blood-red glow from the entryway gone, and the normal image of Dr. Benza standing beside the interface.
Welcome to an asylum, Dr. Benza said. If you're here, that means you've cleared the three dungeons in the area. Congratulations.
Then, as though he felt Hiral's eyes on him, he added,
I'm sure you have many questions, and I would be happy to answer them.
Chapter 2. Evolutions and Explosions. Hiral left the training room with Yanali and his doubles close behind, making his way into the asylum entryway
at the same time Sina and her sister did.
Crisis mode, or whatever it's called, is finished,
Sina called over when she saw him. Looks that way, Hiral said.
Right as I was putting the stew on.
Of course,
Nivian said, coming out of the kitchen while he wiped his hands on his apron.
Stew would have been ready hours ago if you didn't try to cut every vegetable in the garden,
Wool said, coming out behind the sisters with another book in his hands.
Figured you'd be hungry. You have been putting on weight,
Nivian shot back and rolled his hands out and around his stomach.
I have not. Take that back,
Wool said, only to glance down at his stomach and wince.
Okay, maybe I did overindulge a little in stress eating those rations, but healing is hungry work.
Veggies,
Nivian said simply. Then he thumbed back over his shoulder and looked at the others as they gathered around the asylum interface, Dr. Benza smiling beside it.
What are we waiting for?
Yanali asked.
Don't you all need to evolve to D rank? Kaelion?
Wool asked Ciela.
She's still in her room,
Ciela said.
Hasn't come out once. Must still be asleep.
The beds are pretty comfy, considering what we've been sleeping on up till now, Hiral agreed, thinking back on the small dorm rooms that each claimed. Simple, with a bed and desk, but with their own private bathrooms. 18 of them in total. Luxurious compared to the stone cave floors they'd been sleeping on, when they got to sleep at all. But with Cal, it was probably more than just that.
She wouldn't talk to me,
Wool said.
Ciela, is she okay?
Ciela gently shook her head.
Not yet. Maybe not ever. You all know how she felt about Lonil, even if she never admitted it to herself. Worst kept secret, except to her,
Wool said, nodding.
Yeah, and now that she's realized it, I mean, really realized it, she regrets not figuring it out sooner while she still had time,
Ciela said.
How about you?
Nivian asked softly, and the growers all sort of looked at each other. They'd all given each other some space since they got to the asylum, but it looked like the time for being alone was over. They're a party after all. No, we're a party.
Talking helps,
Ciela said, wrapping her arm around Sina's shoulder.
It's still tough, though. I can't believe they're not going to come walking in any second now, you know? Balio and her stupid laugh.
Like a cat dying,
Yanali said seriously.
A wonderful, badass cat,
he quickly amended. Dying. Slowly.
Yeah. I swear she could have used it as an ability in a fight.
Ciela chuckled.
Lonil even tried tickling her one time when we were up against some troublings to see if it would work.
Did it?
Nivian asked, smirking.
Not exactly. Lonil ended up with a broken nose and Cal had to use her long cooldown to fix it. There was so much blood.
Ciela laughed.
Like gushing. Oh, I know I shouldn't think that's funny, but then the last troblin jumped on Piccoli while we were distracted. But Lonil had knocked its teeth out earlier, so when it got her, it just sort of gummed her arm a bit.
She wrapped her lips over her teeth and gnawed on her own arm. Everybody else just looked a little shocked, but once Hiral pictured the scene and failed to stop himself from giggling at it, the others quickly joined in.
Did you just let it chew on Piccoli?
Yanali asked between chuckles.
Nah, Fitch bashed it over the head, then yelled at us for being careless,
Ciela said, tilting her back so she could breathe through the laughter. But when her face came forward again, something inside her just seemed to crack.
I'm going to miss them all. So much.
She clenched her jaw, trying to hold it together. Sina got to her first, wrapping her arms around her sister, and the others quickly followed until it was only Hiral and his doubles standing to the side.
"What are you waiting for?"
Sina asked him quietly, waving him over with small hand gestures. She made room for him when he arrived. Hiral slipped in between Sina and Nivian, joining in the group hug until Ciela's shoulders finally stopped shaking several minutes later.
"Well, that's embarrassing,"
Ciela said as they broke up, wiping her eyes and then her nose.
"No idea what you're talking about,"
Nivian said, his voice cracking a little.
"I didn't see anything. Too busy hugging."
"Me neither,"
Yanli said, eyes red and snot running down his top lip. Ciela forced herself to smile at them, then turned to Dr. Benzo, obviously ready to change the subject.
"Want to see what he has to say?"
"I'm a little afraid to, actually," Will said. "But I guess we have to, don't we?
Hey, we got to level 20 in the Troublin Throne since we had to keep killing the Lord."
Sheena looked at Hiral and quietly asked,
"How close are you?"
"I got 20 too," Hiral said. "Solo experience and that rested bonus ability."
"Overpowered,"
Yanali enunciated specifically, meeting Hiral's eyes.
"He had help," Wright spoke up.
"Only the first time,"
Left clarified.
"Only the—"
Yanali balked.
"Seriously overpowered."
"Yeah, but just wait until you get to enjoy the passive party buff I got from the achievements," Hiral said.
"Then you'll be overpowered too."
You guys did get that party interface ability, right?"
"We did,"
Sina said before Yanali could answer.
"But—"
She looked at the people around the interface.
"Parties can only have 6 people. And we have 7,
Nivian finished.
"We're going to need to figure something out,"
Sina conceded.
"After we talk to Dr. Benzer here and get our evolutions."
She looked directly at Hiral and added,
"Also going to need to coordinate new abilities, from the sounds of things."
Despite the slight glare Sina threw at him, Hiral couldn't help but smile.
"She isn't automatically leaving me out to fit Cal in."
"Happy to," Hiral said. "And like I was telling Yanali earlier, I think I have some ideas on how I can help you guys out with those crystals we got."
"That's great,"
Sina said, then shook her head.
"How do we always get distracted from what we're supposed to be doing?"
She looked back at Dr. Benzer.
"At least there isn't a troubling knowing on your arm,"
Wool said, stifling a laugh.
"There is that,"
Sina said, rolling her eyes before swiping her hand over the interface crystal. Of course, since Dr. Benzer's image was already there, nothing happened.
"Fine. Right. Whatever. Rank evolution."
As soon as she said the words, a streamer of glowing smoke-like light extended out of the interface crystal and connected to the center of Sina's chest. A pulse, and her entire body lit up from within, the dark shadows of roots growing inside her. Pulse after pulse of light, the roots spread further through her body, like they were stretching for the surface of her skin. Then it stopped, the light vanishing like it had never been there.
"Whoa,"
she said, blinking and looking at her hand.
"It's a rush, isn't it?"
Yanali said, gently elbowing her in the shoulder. She looked at Yanali.
"It is. And wow, we get 4 stat points right away."
"Yup. I didn't mention that," he asked innocently.
Too innocently. Sina glared at him, but then her eyes went distant as she regarded her status window.
"Same auto distribution? But now I have an extra free point every level. Nice. I'll just put one here and the other one there. There we go."
Her eyes refocused on the others.
"My body feels lighter, more, I don't know, real. I can't explain it. Who's next?
Ladies first, Hiral said, gesturing for Ciela to go ahead, which she did. Nivian and Wu quickly followed, and then it was Hiral's turn. Even though he had gotten to level 20 in his class, just like they had, the idea of a rank evolution had been nothing but a far, far away fantasy for most of his life. Part of him wondered for a second if this was all just a dream, and he was about to wake up. But then two hands pushed gently on his shoulders from behind.
What are you waiting for? Wright asked. We can't evolve until you do.
Sorry, Hiral said, stepping up closer to the interface crystal, at which point Nivian took an obvious step back. Then two more.
What? The tank asked. You have a tendency to explode.
Oh, shit,
Yanali said, quick stepping back as well.
Is this far enough? Do you think this is far enough?
He asked rapid fire to Sina, who'd also put a good 10 feet between them.
Something I should know?
Ciela asked, seeing Wool also backing away.
Yes, he explodes when he gets excited, Nivian said.
Ciela's eyebrow went up.
Just trust us. Take a few steps back,
Wool said, waving her over. Ciela shrugged and walked over to join Wool.
Okay, let's see the show. I'm not a show. Tell them I'm not going to...
Hiral turned to his doubles, only to find even they'd backed far away from him.
You guys too?
Just safekeeping your solar energy, Left said.
Go, Hiral! You can do it! Rah, rah!
Wright added, pumping his fist in the air.
Sometimes I can't believe we're all part of the same person,
Hiral grumbled, then looked at Dr. Benza.
Rank evolution.
The solar energy wafted up from the interface to connect with the rune of separation and the crystal embedded in his chest. Energy exploded out of him, lifting him to hover 5 feet off the ground and ripping the double helix script off his flesh. Lines and lines of glowing characters orbited around him in a sphere of radiant power, energy dancing across his skin like electricity. And then everything went completely dark. Before he even had a chance to wonder or panic, more of the shimmering script burst through the darkness of his sight. Words, sentences, stories. Lifetimes, truths, primal facts. He saw them all, stretching across the land, the sky, the universe, and into another. A place like his own, but not. A place of power where... The room appeared again in front of Hiral as he dropped straight down, collapsing to the floor in an instant while the glowing script tightened around his body again. The double helix pattern burned into his skin, filling him with the power of his PIM, and some of those truths he had gleaned lingered in front of his eyes.
Ha!
He let out a breath he didn't know he had been holding, the air running up his throat and past his lips, practically scalding hot.
Yeah, a rush, he wheezed.
See? Explodes.
Nivian said from somewhere out of Hiral's line of sight.
You weren't kidding,
Ciela said.
Hiral, hey, you okay?
Sina said, coming over and kneeling down beside him. Then, more quietly, she asked,
You're, done exploding, right?
I think so,
he said, looking up to meet her eyes.
Good.
Her eyebrow slowly climbed up her forehead before she leaned down very close to him. So close, in fact, their noses almost touched as she stared into his eyes.
Sina?
Hiral asked softly, almost afraid to move.
Sina?
Ciela asked, a little more big sister protectively.
Your eyes,
Sina said,
finally pulling back to a more comfortable 2 feet from Hiral's face.
"What's wrong with my eyes?" Hiral asked, a different kind of panic in his chest.
"Your irises, the coloured part of your eyes. There's writing in them, like the stuff on your arms. Glowing. Too small to read, but it's definitely there."
"What? Let me see,"
Yanali said, barging over and also getting far too close to Hiral. With the man's bigger nose, well, they actually touched.
Personal space? Hiral mumbled. "She's right," Yanali said, leaning back like nothing had happened. "Totally glowing eyes. That better not be some other overpowered ability."
"It's not," Hiral said.
"You sure? You checked your status window?"
Yanali snapped back, crossing his arms.
"Well, no," Hiral said, then did just that.
"Nope. No new abilities. Happy?"
"Is exploding listed on your ability section?" Nivian asked.
"What?"
"No," Hiral said. "Then we can't rule out the eye thing,"
Nivian said sagely.
"I didn't explode."
"Yes, you really did," Ciela said. "Just go with it."
"I just... fine. Can somebody help me up?"
Both Yanali and Sina took his hands, lifting him to his feet.
"Thank you.
Guys, shall we?"
He reached out to left and right after Sina and Yanali let go.
"About time," Wright said, taking one hand while left took the other.
"Everybody is such a critic today," Hiral said.
But he absorbed his doubles and immediately activated foundational split. As usual, his tattoos and meridian lines didn't even have a chance to fully rise again to the surface of his skin before they peeled off, smoke-like solar energy stretching out to his sides to solidify into left and right.
"Oh, yeah,"
Wright said, his meridian lines glowing softly.
"That is a rush. I feel like I could run all the way back to the Troublin Keep and solo it."
"Not that you'd be able to get in,"
Left pointed out.
"But I feel the same way.
Why do you guys get a rush, and I feel like I got a bad sunburn?"
Hiral asked, running his hands down his arms, the flesh still abnormally warm.
"Because you exploded,"
Nivian said one more time, in case Hiral had somehow missed it. Chapter 3. Advanced Classes. Hiral ignored the comment, as well as the others chuckling, and turned his attention to the interface.
"Let's find out what he has to say."
"Sure,"
Sina said, one hand in front of her mouth.
"Dr. Benzer, tutorial," Hiral said,
forcing himself to only look straight ahead and to not smile. For the first time in his life, having other people laugh at him felt good. This wasn't like up on Fallen Reach. It wasn't mockery of the Everfail. They laughed because they cared and felt comfortable enough to let their guards down, not to hurt him.
It's kind of nice.
"Accessing PIMs,"
Dr. Benzer said, his voice oddly flat.
"Access complete. All zone dungeon clears detected. Introductory 3 and introductory 4 tutorials unlocked. Please make a selection."
"Let's do them in order,"
Sina suggested, and the others nodded.
"Introductory 3 tutorial, please, Dr. Benzer," Hiral said.
The image shimmered, and then Dr. Benzer was pacing back and forth in front of them.
"Is it recording yet?" "What? Why didn't you say something?" "Oh, fine. Whatever."
He stopped, smoothing out the long robes he wore, then turned his attention towards the party. 1 second ticked by, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then he finally spoke again.
"You made me forget my line," he snapped. "Where's the script?" You guys think he's okay?
Yanali asked. No. No, I don't, Hiral said. But he clapped his mouth closed when Dr. Benza started again.
You know what? I'm just going to wing it. Yeah, you heard me right. And what do you mean it's still recording?
Dr. Benza face-palmed. His shoulders rose and fell, like he was taking a deep breath. And then he lowered his hand and looked straight ahead.
All right, before we start in on introductory three, he said, holding up his hands for air quotes, there's something I want to explain to you first. Now, I need to tell you about this before it leads to things like segregation, paranoia, or oppression. What is that thing? First, go ahead and open up your status windows. Go on. I'll give you a second.
Dr. Benza crossed his arms and tapped his foot.
Should we? Nivian asked.
Might as well, Hiral said, his status window open.
Everybody got their window open? Dr. Benza asked. Good. Now, what's the first thing you see after your name?
My last, Yanali started.
Not your last name,
Dr. Benza said, like he could predict having somebody like Yanali in the room.
Under that.
Race?
Hiral and Sina said at the same time.
Probably says race, he said, again with air quotes. Big R, small A, small C, small E, right? Well, that's not what it's supposed to say. What it should say is RACE. Stands for Role Affinity Classification Engine. That's right. You're all the same race. Surprise! The intern doing the input didn't pay close enough attention. And I hope you're hearing this before anything major happens because of it.
Dr. Benza shook his head at that.
Anything major, like, say, living on separate islands?
Yanali asked.
Shush,
Sina said, then looked over at Hiral and kind of shrugged.
The RACE tag was meant to help streamline what classes people would have access to through their PIMs,
Dr. Benza continued.
It turns out everybody has a kind of affinity, which the classification engine reads during the first interface. Kind of like how the PIM... Oh, sorry. I guess I'm not supposed to talk about PIMs much until introductory four. Back to the main topic, now that we've gotten the race thing out of the way. This tutorial is about classes and dungeon access. I'm sure you've been wondering by now why it takes at least two people from different races to access the dungeons. And it's simple. Cooperation. While we all have the same origin, we're worried that grouping people by their affinities would create cliques and specialized parties. That was a problem. There's the old adage, specialization breeds weakness, and we believe the opposite is needed to defeat the enemy. We need cooperation, adaptability, and variety to win this war. With that in mind, we made it so that at least two of the four races needed to be present to access the dungeon. They'd need to work together to grow stronger. As a pleasant side effect, the nature of magic, which I'll explain more in introductory four, made it a more impactful dungeon experience. But I'll get to that later. Back to cooperation. The most important part was that it'd hopefully also make sure we all focus on the enemy instead of each other. Didn't work so well,
Wool said and looked at Ciela, clearly referencing how she'd been captured by the Shapers.
It didn't, Ciela agreed.
And that's it for dungeon access, Dr. Benza said. On to classes. If you're seeing this message, that means you've cleared at least two E-rank dungeons, so you must be working your way to level 20 and D-rank. I hope you've been enjoying your classes up until this point, but...
The image paused,
the man's lips parting in a knowing grin.
Did you know you'll have an opportunity for a class evolution once you reach D rank?
What? Really? Hiral asked, looking at the growers to see if they'd known. By the expressions on their faces, this was news to them, too. While there were no A ranks on Fallen Reach, there were a few dozen B ranks, as well as plenty of C and D ranks. How had Hiral never heard of class evolutions? Was it a secret to those with classes? No, that didn't make sense. He was the exception, not the rule. So why? His eyes settled on the interface.
Of course, he said. The class evolutions must need the dungeon somehow.
This was probably all explained to you already, before you even got sent to the dungeons.
Dr. Benza went on after his dramatic pause.
Maybe we should just skip this part.
No, six voices said in unison, and everybody looked sheepishly at each other.
Don't worry, I'm kidding, Dr. Benza said. Obviously, I can't trust somebody else to explain something this important without mucking it up. So, class evolutions. Yep. We're getting to the good stuff now. When you reach D rank, a lot of new options will open up to your PIMs, and class evolutions will be one of the biggest and most impactful. Now, I have to warn you, not everybody will have this chance, and class evolutions are only available in D, B, and S ranks. That's right. While the unluckiest of you may potentially never see a class evolution, some of you may even go through three of them. Those that do, well, we've done some calculations on their potential strength, and I have to say, it's a little absurd. From our math, a thrice-evolved S rank would be about as far above a non-evolved S rank as that same non-evolved S rank would be above a B rank. Some people around here are calling the once-evolved S ranks S-plus rank. Twice-evolved are SS-plus rank. And the ultra-rare thrice-evolved are SSS-plus rank. It's a mouthful, I know. Don't worry. The evolutions don't do weird things like make your hair glow and stand on end.
He trailed off, looking past the party like he tended to do.
Okay, I've just been corrected. It's believed that some of the evolutions might do just those things. Guess we'll find out when somebody gets there.
He shrugged.
At least Hiral and Yanali won't have to worry about the crazy hair,
Wool said.
It'll grow back,
Yanali said, rubbing his hand over his still perfectly smooth head, then glanced at Hiral's scalp.
How do you keep it so shiny? The fancy special effects aren't what make the S-plus rank so desirable, though,
Dr. Benza went on, thankfully saving Hiral from having to address Yanali.
Some of the classes do get additional attribute points to distribute, but only some. No, the common theme amongst the evolved classes is clearly the more advanced abilities and ability evolutions. It's not an across-the-board type thing where all the abilities evolve at the same time, but each of the evolved or advanced classes tend to focus on a strength. As you can imagine, considering what I just said about specialization breeding weakness, this made us nervous at first. It was one of the reasons we developed benefits to working in groups. But the theoretical power of the advanced classes, especially when as a member of a party, far outweighed the risks. Really, if any of you watching this get an evolved class, it will be a big step towards victory in our war against the enemy.
Okay, that's great and all, Nivian said. I mean, Yanali is literally drooling over there.
Not because he's thinking about your cooking,
Wool said quietly.
But how do we get these evolved classes?
Nivian continued, while scowling at his twin.
Let's ask, Hiral said. Dr. Benza, how do we get evolved classes?
The image in front of him didn't even shimmer, though Dr. Benza's lips curled up in another smile, like he'd purposely put in a second dramatic pause to make somebody ask the question.
You're probably wondering about how to get an advanced class, right? There are a few ways to do it, though none of them are guaranteed. This goes back to saying that some of you may get one. The advanced classes need to be, let's call it, unlocked. This unlocking process will happen through your own actions and choices while in D, B, or S ranks. Skills you choose to use, how you approach battles, or perhaps how you solve dungeon encounters. All these things will feed into the PIMP and its calculations, judging whether or not you're eligible for an advanced class. Understand this, though. The PIM system was built to make the strong stronger, not to gift the lazy with easy progress. If you don't work for an advanced class, you won't get one. It's that simple.
Dr. Benza stood straighter and crossed his arms.
And that concludes our introductory 3 tutorial. I'll see you in number 4.
The doctor's image shimmered and reverted back to him standing calmly with his hands clasped in front of him.
How much work do you think it is to get one of those advanced classes? Sina asked.
I'd say it's probably doable, Hiral said.
Maybe for you, Mr. Overpowered, Yanali said.
No, seriously, Hiral said.
You already learned that dancing spear style from the lizard men we fought. And you're working on a new technique, right? It sounds like those are exactly the kinds of things considered for the class evolutions.
And I may not be an expert on it, but I'd say nobody here is average. You've all been working hard to improve. I'd honestly be more shocked if we didn't see several class evolutions.
Hiral's right, Sina said. I've known you all our whole lives. If anybody can get these evolutions, it's you guys.
Thanks, boss, Nivian said. So, should we jump right into the 4th tutorial? That was a lot of info.
It was, but pretty straightforward. Let's hear what he has to say about PIMs. Then we can... Well, we'll have to talk about Fallen Reach. That issue isn't going away. I know we all needed some time to decompress, but...
No, you're right, Ciela said. One way or another, we can't hide from what we heard. Putting it off will only make things worse. First PIMs, then Fallen Reach.
Dr. Benza, Introductory 4 tutorial, please. Chapter 4. Balancing Act. Dr. Benz's image did its familiar shimmer, and suddenly the man was tapping his lip like he was thinking about something.
You probably don't know this, the doctor started, but magic is all about balance. Unfortunately, because of the appearance of the enemy, we learned that all too well. Since they arrived, since they've been systematically killing us off, we've been building the planet-wide PIM system. That's probably a lot to digest, so let me start from the beginning before we get into the finer details. Like, for example, why you're not all S-ranked from birth, or what the PIM is in the first place.
Dr. Benza paced side to side like he was lecturing a class.
Magic is about balance. Yes, I said that already, but it's important enough I needed to repeat it. Before we developed the PIM, we had magic. Magic very similar to what you're familiar with. It was part of the world we were born into, and over the course of our history, we learned how to manipulate it. Magic was an integral part of our society. But it was too weak. When the enemy attacked, we were completely overwhelmed. The magic we'd grown so accustomed to, that we relied so heavily on, let us down. We'd been complacent. We felt we deserved the magic, which meant we didn't earn it. Effort equals results, and we didn't put in the effort. That was our first clue. Well, technically our second. Let me back up a minute and tell you about the Fallen.
Hiral's eyes widened. What do the Fallen have to do with anything?
Ah, Dr. Benza said, looking beyond the party and shaking his head. Apparently the Fallen are the topic for the Intermediate 1 tutorial. So please come back after you've cleared your first D-rank dungeon.
He's just a tease, Yanali said.
Yeah, I don't get this censorship, Nivian said. Why doesn't he just tell us everything we need to know? This is actually a good example of balance, Dr. Benza continued, again tapping his lips. It's why we broke up the tutorials into different levels after certain accomplishments, and why we limit the information the public receives. It makes your PIMs more powerful. Okay, I jumped way ahead there. Yes, I know this is what happens when I go off script. Thank you for the reminder. Anyway, going back to the arrival of the enemy. Ahem. When we realized our magic wasn't strong enough and saw an example of stronger magic, we decided to completely start over. Yes, we found a way to utterly destroy the magic system we'd used. Then, and only then, we rebuilt it from the ground up. We sacrificed our history to give our future a chance.
He held out his left hand, then his right.
Balance. We constructed the PIM system based on what the Fallen use, but modified it to take this balance into account in the hopes of forging magic capable of defeating them. Effort equals results. The true power of the PIM isn't how it tells you what your stats are or how it modifies them, but how it grows exponentially based on how much effort you put in. We designed the system to grow with you. The more you grow, the more powerful you get. Kind of obvious, right? To give you an example, our strongest warriors were probably around what you would call low C rank. That was our cap, the most powerful we'd ever get, and not nearly strong enough to stop the enemy. However, by building the PIM to start at the bottom of E rank, the magic balanced it out by giving it a very high ceiling, S rank, or SSS plus rank, if you consider the theoretical class evolutions. We also built in other requirements to push that ceiling up, such as requiring solar energy, the limit of attribute points you get per level, and even levels themselves. Yes, having 20 levels per rank instead of, say, 1, allowed the PIM to be more powerful overall. It's why we went to all the trouble of building dungeons and the Fallen Reach. These efforts allowed us to create a magic system with tremendous potential. Enough potential, we believe, to finally defeat the enemy and the Fallen.
A shiver ran through Hiral's body. Why did he just group the Fallen in with the enemy? He asked quietly, and the growers in the room looked his way.
We gave up everything to build the PIM system, Dr. Benza went on, like nobody had said anything. But what is it? Personal interface magic? It sounds so simple, doesn't it? The status window you can pull up conveniently tells you what your stats and abilities are. But is that all the PIM does? Rhetorical question, I know. It does far more than that, though that is where we started when building it. The PIM both reports on and modifies your attributes. It's part of who you are, but also separate, all at the same time. It's the lens through which magic is focused into you, but also a filter that feeds information back to the PIMP. Balance. Now, I can't go into details on the PIMP in this tutorial, but needless to say, it's integral to the magic of the PIM system.
Dr. Benza then held his hand up beside his mouth.
It's also listening to what I say,
he added more quietly, giving a wink.
An added bonus to the PIM growth as you cross ranks is that it allows the incorporation of more and more outside influences. What do I mean by this? At E rank, the gear you can get from dungeons is somewhat limited, in that it can modify abilities to a certain extent, or, more likely, grant new ones. Don't get me wrong. Versatility is very important, but not always a direct path to increased power. Once you reach D rank, you can also start getting equipment that will give you things like bonus attributes. Need more strength? You can get rings that do that, because your PIM has evolved to have that functionality. Neat, huh? Also, in case you didn't guess it, this is part of that balance I was talking about.
Wait, Nivian, don't you already have an amulet that increases your endurance? Hiral asked, thinking back to their first dungeon.
Not exactly, Nivian explained. It doesn't actually up my endurance number, but makes me tougher relative to my strength and dexterity. Kind of like armor. It doesn't make me get tired slower or anything. As for how the PIM manifests itself, Dr. Benza continued, well, that goes back to our race discussion from Introductory 3. The four races identified by the classification engine have different PIM manifestations, each with their own advantages. The makers, for example, need to have their skin inked to access the power of their PIMs. Growers have roots, growing within them, while bonders rely on their animal companions. Builders, finally, have the truths of the universe written on their skin, which allows them to power the runes they inscribe in crystals. Each of these systems has strengths and weaknesses. For example, only the growers are truly self-sufficient, needing no outside objects or help. Makers, on the other hand, can manifest very powerful tattoos, assuming they were inked on their skin by another. Balance, Dr. Benza said again, holding up his hands. And that is the end of the introductory tutorials. I'll see you again after you've cleared your first D-rank dungeon. Who knows? Maybe one of you watching this will even have your own class evolution by then.
With that, the image reverted to the standard waiting image they'd seen earlier, and all eyes turned to Hiral, who looked down at the runes on his arms.
The truths of the universe? Is that what the double helix pattern is? But he said builders needed to use the runes inscribed in crystal. There must still be more to it.
Overpowered, Yanali said. We get roots and he gets the truths of the universe. How is that fair? He also explodes, Nivian said.
So, Hiral, I always thought Fallen Reach was just a name,
Sina said, ignoring the banter in a practiced fashion.
You brought up the Fallen a couple of times in all that. Anything you can share?
Hiral let his arms drop to his sides. He could mull over Dr. Benza's words later and looked at his party.
Fallen Reach is named after the Fallen, as you can probably guess, he said with a small chuckle. They were heroes, or so history tells us. They were the ones who put Fallen Reach in the sky to chase the sun.
That doesn't exactly match up with what the Doctor was saying, Yanali said.
It doesn't, though maybe we're missing something. He said he couldn't talk about it until the intermediate tutorial, so...
Hiral trailed off with a shrug.
Are they important to you? Cena asked. The Fallen, I mean. Do you worship them or anything up on the island?
No, Hiral said immediately with a shake of his head. Like the tattoos, he thumbed at left and right. They're part of our legends. The towers are named after them, the ones we use to tell time, because one passes every hour. But other than that, they're basically just a footnote.
Do you know anything about them? Vivian asked. Anything that might be a hint?
Hiral ran his hand over his scalp while he thought about it, then shook his head again. Honestly, no. Other than them being heroes, I don't think I've ever read anything about them. We use them in our curses. He chuckled.
Well, I guess we'll find out more when we get to the next tutorial, Cena said.
Are we going to get to the next tutorial? Nivian asked. I think it's time we have this conversation. Don't get me wrong. That stuff about the PIM was interesting and all, but it doesn't change what Dr. Benza said when we got here about Fallen Reach crashing.
It's kind of moot, isn't it? Yandali asked. Even if we wanted to do anything about it, and if the doc here would tell us anything, Fallen Reach passed by ages ago. We can't catch up.
If I may?
Left asked, and the others looked at him. Got an idea? Hiral asked.
Possibly, the double answered.
Hiral glanced at the others, and when they didn't have any objections, he nodded at Left.
Dr. Benza, Left said, can you tell us more about Fallen Reach crashing?
The image of the doctor shifted briefly and then shook his head.
Crisis response data is limited to those at C rank and above, or those at D rank with evolved classes and above,
he said with that monotone voice he used sometimes.
If we were going to Fallen Reach anyway, would you tell us?
Left persisted.
No, Dr. Benza said. Access is limited, as outlined previously, and cannot be circumvented.
Think this is one of those balance things? Hiral asked Left.
Possibly, at least partially,
Left said, not turning away from the image.
Dr. Benza, when we leave this asylum to get to the next one, how do we travel?
Another image shift.
A disk of passage will take you to the next zone of your choice when you're ready to continue your growth.
Of our choice? Doctor, can you show us a map of the zones?
Dr. Benza's image stuttered to the side, and a glowing 3-foot sphere appeared beside him. Blue, green, brown. The colours started blurry at first, then sharpened as mountains grew, rivers connected to lakes and seas, and a wind seemed to blow across the grassy plains.
This is our world?
Wu asked, stepping closer to the incredibly detailed globe.
It appears so,
Left said,
and a far better depiction of it than I'd hoped. Dr. Benza, where are we?
A blinking blue dot appeared on the side of the globe closest to Left. Taking a step forward, Left reached out and touched the sphere, then gently squeezed his fingers closer together, the whole globe shrinking in response. A smile quirked the double's lips as he reversed the motion, making the sphere grow until it was as big as they were.
How did you know it would do that? Hiral asked. We don't have anything like this on Fallen Reach. Just a hunch, Left said. Regardless, this is where we are. And I believe these are the Needle Mountains.
He was pointing surprisingly far to the south.
Is our world really small? Yanali asked. That seems pretty far away.
The disks move really fast, Hiral said. Assuming they're like the tattoos, I mean. We could have easily travelled 700 miles or more in the 2 hours we were on it. Somebody whistled at the number.
And if these are the needles, that means this is the Ensath River,
Left continued, drawing his finger in a line between the mountains.
And the Sea of White beyond. Dr. Benza, can you show us where Fallen Reach is now?
A blinking yellow dot appeared above the sea of white.
See? Yanali said. Even if we wanted to go, we're never going to catch up to it. We have to wait for it to come around again.
Dr. Benza, please show us the zones we'd have access to travel to,
Left said, and different areas on the globe glowed a soft red, dotted lines connecting them to the blinking blue dot.
I see what you're thinking, Hiral said, looking at the lit-up zones and walking around the globe.
None of them are beside the river, though. Even if we get ahead of the island, we need a jump point.
Get ahead? How?
Yanali started.
The discs, Sina caught on. Left and Hiral are suggesting we take a disc to a zone near the Ensath River, ahead of Fallen Reach, then jump when it gets close.
Exactly,
Left said.
The Ensath River runs along the equatorial line of the planet, almost too perfectly to be natural when looking at it like this.
There are academics who are pretty sure it isn't natural, Hiral said for the grower's benefit. Something to do with the pulses is one theory.
Sorry, that's not important now,
he added as he finished his second rotation around the globe.
I checked again. None of these zones are where we need them to be.
Left?
Dr. Benza, assuming we clear the three dungeons in the D-rank zone, will we have access to another asylum and the zones connected to it?
Left asked.
Yes, Dr. Benza said simply.
Can you show us the connected zones and their ranks?
More areas blossomed red, though this time they were slightly different shades and had large letters in the middle of them.
D and C zone ranks?
Nivian asked, looking at one of the zones.
Must be, Sina said. Anybody see one beside the river?
Here, Hiral said, putting his finger on the globe, and the others rushed around to join him.
It's actually not too far ahead of us, and just two trips.
He traced his finger along the dotted lines back to the blinking blue dot.
Do any of you know this area?
Wright asked.
Can you make it bigger again, Left? Sina asked. This area, right here.
Left put both his hands on the globe and then gently pulled them apart, increasing the size of the globe even further. Interestingly enough, as the sphere grew, it also rose up into the air, forcing the group to tilt their heads back while they looked at the planet Left seemed to be holding above them.
That's enough, Sina said.
Explains why this room is so big, Hiral mumbled, looking at how the globe almost reached the tall ceiling. The details of the map, on the other hand, were impressive.
I think I know this area, Sina said. Nivian, do these look like the horns to you?
She pointed at a pair of curved mountains straddling the Ensath River.
Those are definitely them, the tank said.
These are jump points, Sina said, tapping the mountains, though her finger barely made the light shimmer.
So, Hiral said, nodding as the pieces came together in his head.
We take a disc of passage from here to this zone.
He drew his finger along the line, connecting the blue dot to the first zone.
Clear the three dungeons there, get to the next asylum, then immediately take another disc to here.
He traced along the second connecting line.
From there, Sina picked up, we cross the zone, ignoring the dungeons if we have to get to the jump point before Fallen Reach does. Are you sure the discs are fast enough to get us ahead of the island?
Dr. Benza, can you add a scale of distance to the map?
Left asked, and a small notation appeared in the corner.
We have about 200 to 250 hours until Fallen Reach arrives at the Horns. I estimate each of the disc trips is roughly 2 or 3 hours.
Easy peasy, Yanali said. There's also the time we need to clear the dungeons, Vivian said.
Not to mention getting to them, Wool said. This zone looks huge. We're going to be doing most of this on foot, remember?
Then there's the rain, Hiral said. And everybody just kind of paused. If it's light,
I think we can pretty safely move through it. But if it's storming, that seems to be when the enemy comes out. We need to think about hiding when the rain is at its heaviest.
There's also the issue of needing to be C rank or have an evolved class to get any information about what's going on up there,
Ciela said.
But that's something we can work on while we travel. If we get to this zone ahead of schedule,
she pointed at the zone with the horns in it,
we can always go to the dungeons there to farm.
You think we should go? Sina asked her sister.
How can we stay here safe and sound if what Dr. Benza says is true?
Ciela asked.
Even if he won't tell us what's going on, Favela is back there. I'm going.
And we're going with you, Sina said, glancing at her party members, each of whom nodded at her in turn.
I guess it's settled then,
Yanali said.
When do we leave?
Not until at least after dinner,
Nivian said. Chapter 5. Rune Testing. Hiral stretched as he leaned back from the workbench, his finished products lying on the table in front of him. Ciela had wanted some time to talk to Kalyan and explain what was happening before they left. And, of course, there was the issue of dinner. Then they'd have one last good rest. That gave Hiral a couple of hours to work with the crystal they'd found back in the mire and the Troblin throne. The small projects for Yanali and Nivian had gone relatively quickly, though molding crystal had been a bit more difficult than he'd expected. It wasn't that the material was difficult to work with. In fact, it was just the opposite. It was too malleable. He did everything with his hands directly, including inscribing the runes into the crystal, and even slight pressure could completely ruin it. He'd had to start the first project for Yanali over more than a dozen times. The large ring had taken the longest time, with its hundreds of pieces and needing to make sure the edges were seamless. But even that was done. Though what the ring actually did, yeah, that was still a mystery.
Progress?
Left asked as he walked into the workroom with Wright, the second double flipping one of the small crystal chips they'd found in the Troblin throne up from his thumb and catching it.
Yes, finally, Hiral said. How long until dinner?
15 minutes, Wright said.
Found out what these are too,
he added, holding up the chip.
Tell me on the way, Hiral said, picking up three of the small crystals with runes inscribed in them.
While one was just a flat rectangle, about as long as Hiral's hand, the other two were small discs that would fit in his palm.
Yanali is back in the training room,
doing his bunny,
Wright confirmed.
Perfect. That's our first stop, Hiral said, heading out with his doubles beside him.
He couldn't help but look up at the glowing globe dominating the room.
Left, I know I've said this already, but good job figuring out a way back to Fallen Reach for us.
That's what I'm here for, Left said.
So, Wright, the chips? Hiral asked.
They're currency, Wright said.
Dr. Benza explained it through the help section. Apparently, as we fight monsters, these will charge up with some of the solar energy from the things we beat. That solar energy can then be used to buy things in the asylums.
What?
Where?
Hiral asked.
From the interface, Wright said. There's a new option called Shop, and the dog said it was like a... What did he call it, Left? A vending machine, whatever that is,
Left said.
The interface shop apparently connects to the vault Dr. Benza had mentioned before. I took a look at some of the items available, as well as the amount of currency we have from killing the Troblin Lord 5 times each. It's a surprising amount, and I have a few recommendations on what we should buy.
Oh, we already have some of this currency, Hiral asked.
That's nice. Can you tell us about your suggestions over dinner?
Just then, they entered the training room and found Yanali hard at work.
Yes,
Left said, then added more quietly.
We have two parties' worth of currency for one, so...
Hiral could only shake his head at that. The currency situation was good, kind of. But how had they gotten there? By losing five people? Nothing even close to good. With a second shake of his head, he couldn't do anything about it for the moment. He turned his attention back to the spear warden.
"Think I've got something to help you out with your new move, Yanali," Hiral said, holding up the three crystals between his fingers.
"What you got there?"
Yanali asked, jogging over.
"Runes," Hiral said, "like I use. But I put them into these crystals using my class ability, Mold Crystal.
These little devices will basically activate a very specific function of the rune when you thread solar energy into them."
"What's the specific function?"
Yanali asked, leaning forward to look at what Hiral was holding.
"The first one here is for your spear. It's the rune of attraction, and when you put your solar energy into it, it should draw your spear towards your target."
"Should?"
Yanali asked, one eyebrow going up.
"First time I've done this. Give me a break," Hiral explained. "When I inscribe the rune in the crystal, I have to focus on a concept. It's hard to explain. That will be part of the trigger. For this, I focused on the concept of your target. Whatever you consider your target, well, the spear should be attracted to it. I figure it will help you with the coming down part of your leap attack."
"Okay, I like the sound of that. How do I use it?"
"I need to attach it to your spear. Just below the blade would be best, I think. May I?"
Yanali handed the spear over. With a quick application of his mold crystal, Hiral wrapped the crystal band around the haft and secured it so that it was basically a piece of the spear itself.
"There, that should do it," he said, handing the spear back to Yanali.
"Can I test it out?" Yanali asked.
"Oh, please do, in case there are, any kinks we need to work out."
Hiral shrugged.
"Kinks?
First time. Anyway, focus on one of those practice dummies as your target and see what it feels like."
Hiral made sure not to stand in front of the spear.
"Okay, so I just need to..." "Whoa!"
Yanali shouted, the spear ripping out of his hands and shooting forward 10 feet to embed itself in the dummy.
That wasn't what I expected to happen."
"Me neither," Hiral said. "But at least we know it works."
"Losing my spear isn't exactly a success," Yanali pointed out.
"It's not perfect, no," Hiral agreed. "You're going to be using it after you've jumped, though, not while you're on the ground. Try it out after we put these runes to work, and then we'll see if we need to make some adjustments."
"Why do I feel like a test subject?" Yanali asked.
But he retrieved his spear and came back over to join Hiral.
"You get used to it after a while,"
Wright said with a chuckle.
"Now, these two runes," Hiral said, while ignoring his double's comments, "these are for your boots, runes of rejection. The plan is for them to help you jump higher, faster. They're going to have similar force to the spear, though, which is why I wanted to try it first, so you could see how much energy was involved. I'm going to put them in the heels of your boots." He looked down at Yanali's feet.
"Do I need to take them off?"
Yanali asked, also looking down at the hydroscale boots he'd gotten from the mire.
"Would be easier," Hiral said flatly.
"Fine," Yanali whined.
He dropped to his ass on the ground and took off one boot, then the other, handing them to Hiral.
"Should be pretty easy to do this,"
Hiral muttered to himself, moulding the crystal to the heel of the boot and then making it as thin as possible.
"This should do it.
Might feel a little odd walking until you get used to it."
He handed back the first boot.
"What if I only put solar energy into one boot?" Yanali asked.
"Probably only that foot will jump. There could be situations where it's a good thing, but practice and testing."
He then handed back the second boot.
Okay, let's do this,
Yanali said after he got his boots back on, standing up and taking a few test steps.
Feels a bit different. Do I look taller?
Hiral just looked at Yanali, then at the practice dummy.
Yeah, fine. Testing. Got it?
Yanali dropped into his fighting stance.
Should I try it with one of my spear styles?
Let's just start with seeing how high you jump, Hiral said. Yanali looked at the hole in the practice dummy from his launching spear, then nodded.
Good idea. I'll just... Whoa!
He launched end over end, 10 feet into the air. His boot stayed firmly planted on the ground.
Whoops, Hiral said,
Yanali crashing to the ground a short distance away and immediately jumping to his bare feet.
What was that?
He asked, his empty hand pointing emphatically at the boots, clearly not on his feet.
I may have been focusing on you leaping into the air instead of rejecting the ground when I inscribed those runes,
Hiral said, considering where he might have gone wrong.
Can you fix them?
Yanali asked, while both right and left chuckled.
Yeah, won't even take a minute,
Hiral said, quickly picking up one boot, then the other, and re-inscribing the runes, careful to focus on the floor this time.
That should do it. Ready to give them a try? Little nervous too,
Yanali said.
But no pain, no gain, right? As long as it's your pain and not mine,
Wright said.
At least you're not exploding,
Left pointed out.
I don't explode,
Hiral deadpanned.
Wait, exploding is a possibility?
Yanali asked, glancing down at his feet like they were suddenly very dangerous things.
Like Hiral said, this is his first time,
Left explained.
Of course it's possible.
The spearman started.
If you were going to explode, it would have already happened,
Hiral said with a wave of his hand.
Just get back to testing. You knew it was possible to explode,
Yanali said quietly, but then just sort of shook his head and shrugged.
Meh. Small possibility,
Hiral said quietly, so that only Left and Right could hear. The doubles shook their heads while Yanali dropped back into his fighting stance. This time, when he threaded solar energy into his boots, he launched into the air, keeping his footwear, in a controlled leap that arced almost gracefully until he landed 15 feet away.
Nice, Hiral said. How did it feel? Not bad. It'll take some getting used to, and I've got to use the spear part while I'm up in the air there, but... Yeah, not bad. Thanks, Hiral.
Yanali turned around and then leapt again to get back to Hiral and his copies. The man stumbled a bit on the landing, only staying upright this time because Wright caught him. But he had a huge grin on his face.
You should have a bit of time to practice before we go. Make the most of it,
Hiral said.
I've got to go give Nivian his thing. You got a thing for Nivian?
Wu asked, wandering into the training room with another book in his hands.
Did you get me anything? You made jumping boots for Nivian too?
Yanali asked without responding to Wu.
Oh, please tell me you made them for Ciela. I would pay to see that. Jumping boots?
One of Wu's eyebrows had climbed to his hairline.
And Ciela? Never mind. I don't think I want any part of this. Actually, do me a favour and forget I was even here.
Something a bit different, Hiral said with a chuckle to Yanali.
Though I'll keep that last part in mind if I run short on chips. Anyway, good luck with this. Right, you'll help him. I've got some experience being thrown around by your runes,
Wright said.
I'll make sure he gets the full lesson. Back to my book then,
Wool said.
Actually,
Yanali interrupted, before either Hiral or Wool could get more than a step.
Since you're both here,
What do you say about helping me work out the kinks, Hiral? It's been a while since we did any sparring. I'll even go easy on you, and we'll can patch you right up.
Wright's knuckles cracked as he grinned.
That's a lot of confidence you've got going on there.
Yanali quickly looked at Hiral, then left and right, only then remembering they were actually part of Hiral's ability. Sparring with him would mean sparring with all three of them.
Just you, Hiral. You know, so you can get some practice if, they are too busy to help you.
Too busy doing what? Left asked.
Helping Nivian in the kitchen? Wool asked. I know that gets me all the time.
Exactly, Yanali said, latching onto the excuse.
And no S-rank sword of unfairness.
I'm the one getting the handicaps, and you're going to go easy on me, Hiral asked.
Generous, right? Yanali asked, spear spinning in his hands. So, what do you say?
Hiral thought about it for a second. Getting a bit of a workout after all the time in the workshop might be a nice break. Then tossed his present for Nivian to left.
Hold on to that for me, will you? You really going to make us sit out? Wright asked, clearly disappointed.
Don't worry. If he embarrasses me too much, we'll gang up on him for revenge later.
Fine.
Wright went over to join Left and Wool near the wall, with only a minor pout. Hiral, for his part, unslung his RHCs, his runic hand cannons from his thighs, the weight comfortable in his hands, then went through a few light stretches.
Try not to outright kill each other, Wool said, barely looking over the top of his book. Or break too many bones. Only Cal can heal those. I can probably handle a minor maiming now, though. Does maiming come in minor? Left asked. Objectively speaking, Wool said, when I'm not the one being maimed. Yes.
Fair. Hiral just shook his head and put the banter out of his mind, turning his attention to the spearman across the training hall from him. Yanali wasn't all talk. If Hiral didn't take the spar seriously, well, getting embarrassed wasn't an exaggeration. The man likely wouldn't try to hurt Hiral, and Wool was around in case of any accidents, but... That competitive part of Hiral was rising in his gut, demanding he push to see how far he could go, how far he'd come.
You ready?
Yanali asked, spear still spinning lazily from hand to hand. Are you? Hiral asked, but didn't wait for the man to answer. Rejection burst under his feet as he shot straight ahead, RHCs coming up in a snap, his fingers squeezing the triggers. Bolts of energy-infused impact, thanks to the modifications he'd made to the weapons, zipped ahead at the wide-eyed spearman. Even though he obviously expected Hiral to try and keep his distance with his ranged weapons, Yanali didn't miss a beat, tightening the rotation of his spear's movements. Just like the lizardmen in the Mire dungeon, both bolts deflected off the spear's shaft, harmlessly passing Yanali by. In that same movement, he darted forward, the blunt end of the weapon seamlessly coming around to bludgeon Hiral across the top of the head as they streaked for each other. There was a challenge in that simple movement, lightning fast as it was. Yanali had used the blunt end on purpose. Hiral resisted the urge to scoff at the spearman for underestimating him and twisted to the side, just enough that the spear's haft passed an inch in front of him. Momentum carrying him forward, Hiral started to slip behind Yanali, only to catch the pointy end of the spear in his peripheral vision, streaking at him from the continued rotation. Maybe Yanali hadn't underestimated him after all, and Hiral dropped to his knees to slide along the ground and under the spear. 2 feet past the other man, a burst of rejection kicked Hiral back up to his feet, and he spun just in time to find Yanali already after him. A thrust for his chest, another sidestep, then a second thrust, parried aside with an RHC,
A third dodged, a fourth ducked under, and a fifth had had Hiral flipping and diving to the side. His high dexterity and attunement were letting him keep up with the barrage, but Yanali's reed spear style was no joke. He couldn't let the other man stay on the offensive. The moment he hit the ground from the dive, Hiral rolled back to his feet and spun, pointing the RHC in his right hand at Yanali. A pull of the trigger at the same time Yanali's spear came around to block the expected blast, and it was a race as to which would arrive first. Time seemed to slow as the searing bolt of impact cut through the space, as it got deflected up to strike the ceiling somewhere above, as Hiral's eyes never left the spearman. He didn't have the same attunement Hiral did, but Yanali's instincts were scary good, completely negating the advantage Hiral should have at a range. So he launched himself back in instead of firing his second shot when time snapped back to normal speed. Yanali just grinned, sliding ahead to meet him. Down and at an angle, the spear's blade practically whistled as it streaked for Hiral's shin, forcing him to stop short and lift his lead foot. With Hiral's legs still in the air, Yanali continued his spin, having swapped to dancing spear style, but Hiral hip-fired his other RHC. The blast deflected harmlessly off the spear's shaft, though the move forced Yanali to change his tempo and bought Hiral the second he needed to plant his foot. Then, not slowing, Hiral stepped in with an angled, rising knee. Yanali's spear moved perfectly to block the strike, and his eyes widened as he realized it was a feint. As soon as knee collided with spear, Hiral twisted at the hip just a touch more and turned the knee into a kick. This time it was Yanali who went diving to the side, though the spearman quickly rolled to his feet and spun, weapon already moving. Up and around, Yanali's spear came as Hiral gave chase, forcing him to duck low to evade the sweeping blade, while he brought his own RHC in tight to his chest and pulled the trigger. Close like they were, it would be impossible for Yanali to block the blast. Except, the nimble spearman didn't even try. Continuing the rotation of his spear like it was the most natural thing in the world, the movement of the weapon twisted Yanali's body so the bolt of impact slipped between his torso and arm, while the spear arced for Hiral's thigh. High enough he couldn't lift his leg, and low enough he couldn't dodge, it was a masterful counterattack. One Hiral was ready for, and his second RHC dropped down to block the strike. Crystal rang out against the twisted metal of Yanali's spear, while Hiral gave silent thanks to how sturdy his weapons had been built, and he pivoted to shoulder check into Yanali. Little more than a shove, it pushed the spearman back on his heels, and Hiral thrust out with his RHC. Still on cooldown, he didn't bother pulling the trigger, but instead just stabbed it into Yanali's chest. Though neither move did any damage through Yanali's Hydra scale armor, they did keep him from falling into one of his weapon styles, and Hiral pressed in. Close as he was, with Yanali off balance, he had the chance to. Solar energy flared from the soles of Yanali's boots, and the man vaulted away from Hiral, instantly opening a dozen feet between them. "I feel like that's cheating," Hiral grumbled as Yanali landed and caught his balance, a huge grin on the spearman's face. "On the contrary, isn't that the whole point of this spar?" Yanali said, dropping down again into a comfortable fighting stance. "But Hiral, I have to ask, is that all you've got?" Hiral narrowed his eyes at the man across the room, and specifically at the smile. Yanali was enjoying this. A lot. And though it took him a second to realize it, so was Hiral. They'd pushed each other, though neither went all out, and it was pretty much a draw. Sure, Hiral had landed a pair of hits, but they weren't anything more than no damage taps. No, if either wanted to break the stalemate, they were going to have to up their game. "Let's do it." Solar energy weaved its way to his rune of rejection at the same time Yanali activated his boots, and the two shot directly at each other.
A second burst of rejection pulled Hiral up short, while a tug with his rune of attraction yanked on Yanali's spear to pull him off balance. Unfortunately, it did little more than pull the weapon past Hiral, though it was enough to let him slip in close. From there, the RHC in his right hand came up in front of his chest, and he pulled the trigger to fire at the man beside him. Spear twisting, Yanali used the momentum of the weapon to bend over backwards, the blast zipping by straight above them, then rolled out of it in an athletic move that defied understanding. One moment it looked like he was going to fall to his back on the floor, and the next his weapon was stabbing straight for Hiral's face. Rejection pushed the weapon just wide of punching into his cheek. That kind of maiming might be beyond Wool's abilities, the speed of it hauling the air across his skin, and he hip-fired his other RHC again. A small twist of Yanali's wrist deflected the bolt, barely, and then Hiral was in close, even as the pair moved to circle each other. Spear against runic hand cannons, the weapons played out at their least ideal ranges, as Hiral and Yanali jockeyed for position. While the spearmen tried to force distance between them, just an extra foot or two, Hiral fought to stay as close as possible, even if it meant his shots always came at bad angles. Solar energy flared under Yanali's boots to jump away again, but Hiral wasn't going to let him do that a second time. A flood of energy to his rune of attraction turned the leap into little more than a hop, completely negating the move, and Yanali seemed to accept that was the range they were going to fight at. Choking his hands up higher on the shaft of the spear, he wielded it like a quarterstaff, keeping it closer to his body in a blur to turn aside Hiral's blasts. Practically on cooldown, the spearman managed to parry or evade the shots, while Hiral danced between the near-constant sweeps from the spear. Even though they were so close, it would be intimate in any other circumstance. The problem was, they were falling back into Yanali's tempo. The man was just too good at controlling the fight. And Hiral wasn't making any ground just by pushing harder. It was like everything he did, Yanali rose to meet it. Pushing, huh? Weapons a blur as they moved around each other, Hiral kept his RHCs above his waist, gradually bringing his shots higher and higher, forcing Yanali to raise his weapon to keep up. From deflecting near his chest to blocking shots aimed for his face, Yanali didn't slow in the least. He didn't even wince at the shots that could break bone, or worse, he just kept going. And even though Hiral felt like he was directing the fight, some small part of him was screaming that Yanali was the one leading him around. Which meant he needed to act. Now. One RHC after another, Hiral pulled the trigger, watching Yanali watching him for the trick they both knew had to be coming. Right weapon, straight for Yanali's face, deflected aside. Left, dodged underneath. Right caught in tight and pulled off target. Left, ducked under. Right, hooked under the barrel to shoot high. Left, sidestepped. Yanali was leading him, purposefully only making contact with the weapon in Hiral's right hand. And if Hiral was realizing that, it was leading to something. Yanali was anticipating everything he was doing, countering it. What could he do that Yanali wouldn't expect? Hiral threw his RHC at his opponent, Yanali's eyes scrunching up in confusion, even as the spear instinctively came up and slapped it aside. Moving forward in that brief opening, Hiral's now empty hand continued past the spear. He wasn't close enough to land a punch, at least not before the spear came back across hard enough to likely break his arm. Good thing he wasn't trying to hit Yanali yet. Instead, his open hand erupted with a burst of rejection right in front of the spearman. The sheer amount of solar energy he'd released threw Yanali back like a rag doll, flipping through the air, though he still managed to bat Hiral's other RHC blast like he knew it was coming, while upside down. Hiral was already hot after him, though, and as soon as Yanali's feet touched down, an impact-enhanced fist whipped around with enough bad intentions to make Wright proud, before stopping an inch in front of Yanali's face.
Give up? Hiral asked, the rune glowing between his knuckles and Yanali's nose.
Was just going to ask you the same thing, Yanali said, his eyes darting from Hiral's face to somewhere lower.
Following the other man's look, Hiral glanced down to find the tip of Yanali's spear brushing up against the side of his abdomen.
I would have hit you first, Hiral said lamely.
Then they both chuckled at that.
Ah, who am I kidding? You controlled that fight from beginning to end. You didn't do so bad yourself, Yanali said, as Hiral took a step back. I've got some pointers for you, if you're interested.
Definitely, Hiral said. I'm not too proud to say no to improving. But after dinner, I need to get over and talk to Nivian before that.
Yeah, that's fine. We still have time, Yanali said. Off you go then. Wright can keep me company.
Wright just nodded, while Wool looked up from his book just long enough to make sure everybody still had all their pieces attached. When he was sure nothing was missing, his eyes went right back to the page, and he exited ahead of Hiral.
You did well, Left said, as he and Hiral started for the kitchen. I also have some pointers if you're open to hearing them.
Sure I am, Hiral said, as he walked with Left. He wasn't kidding when he had told Yanali he'd be happy to get some advice. And Left had a keen eye for things. Speaking of which,
you know, I never asked. What are you putting your fourth stat point into now that we're D rank? Intelligence, Left said right away. You've got attunement covered, and all the growers have very good wisdom. I figured I would specialize in that to balance out the group.
Makes sense. It's what I would do. Guessing Wright is doing something similar? Probably strength?
Exactly, Left explained as they entered the workshop again. You and Yanali focus more on dexterity, but we felt Wright could offer big, single-hit decisiveness. Like Balio did.
Definitely something we need, even if Yanali's new training pays off. What do you think? Can he force an ability evolution by practicing something like that?
I'd need more data points to speak definitively on the subject, Left said. But I believe it's possible. For you as well. From what Dr. Benza was saying, it sounds like the PIMP system is almost like a living entity. One constantly growing and evolving. I suspect there are even abilities and combinations not foreseen by the creators. What the system is today may not be the same thing as what they believed it would be all those years ago when they built it.
He finished as the pair entered the kitchen. Hiral could only nod. There was so much they didn't know about the PIM and the PIMP. Still, as long as it gave them the avenue they needed to get stronger, did it really matter? It was obviously already catering to their needs with the specific loot and abilities it provided. So for now, he'd just have to trust it to do its thing. Meanwhile, he'd do his.
Hey, Nivian, I've got a present for you, he said, holding up his new runic device.
This one should work a little smoother than Yanali's. Should.
Chapter 6. Party Formation.
You can't be serious, Nivian said, as the eight of them sat around the table, plates full of piled food.
Cal wants to stay behind? Here? By herself?
That's what she told me, Ciela said,
and Hiral looked to the empty ninth chair set at the large table. The healer hadn't come out of her room, not even once since they'd arrived, but Ciela had found a way in. When she'd come back out for dinner, she'd dropped the news on them. Cal didn't plan to leave until Fallen Reach came around again.
What's she going to do here by herself? Wool asked. It's not just a few hours alone, it's basically a whole rotation.
She's got that mirror, Hiral said, thinking back to the item she'd gotten from the Troublin Throne dungeon.
The Mirror of Memories, I think it was called when I used view on it. Any idea what it even does? Wool asked. No, never mind, that's not important. We need to change her mind. Bring her with us.
You suggesting we tie her up and make Nivian carry her over his shoulder? Sina asked. Because from what Ciella was telling me, that's what it's going to take.
She's shaken, badly, Ciella said. The loss, what happened to the others. She thinks we never should have left that first dungeon. Partly blames herself too, I think, since she was the group's healer.
She wasn't even there, or conscious for most of it, Wool said. How can she blame herself?
It's not logical. It's grief,
Left spoke up.
I'm sure there are a dozen things she wishes she could go back and do differently. And no matter what we say to her, nothing will change her mind until she's ready for it. This isn't a process we can force.
So you think we should just leave her?
Wool asked.
I think we should consider her wishes, Left said.
I hate to be the one to say this, Yandley started, but I'm going to anyway. Cal's staying behind, as much as I don't like it, solves an issue about party size and dungeons.
Hiralspoon paused on the way to his mouth, a mix of relief and hesitance churning in his chest. He had been thinking the same thing. Everybody must have been. But it was always the question of who was going to mention it. Thank you, Yanali. From the looks on the others' faces, Hiral wasn't the only one feeling that way.
Yanali has a point, Sina agreed. Look, I'm not happy about it either, but with the party interface option and the limits on going into the dungeons, it's something we need to actually talk about. We can't just pretend it's not a thing.
We could hold off on forming the party through the interface, Nivian offered. Do it like we've always done it. Alternate somebody in and out to get all seven of us through the dungeon.
That's always an option, if she agrees to come with us, Sina said. Ciella, really, if we hold off on leaving for a bit, do you think she'll change her mind? From what Left says, we don't have to head out immediately.
To be clear, there are a number of unknowns, Left said. Sooner would be better, but there is probably some leeway.
She's not going to change her mind, at least not any time soon, Ciella said. I've seen her like this before. Should one of us stay with her?
Wu asked, but all eyes settled on Ciella. Out of everybody, it would have to be her. Wu, Nivian and Hiral were all needed for the dungeon runs. They were part of Sina's party, so it meant she would be going. And then Yanali, well, Yanali wasn't somebody who got left behind to offer moral or emotional support. Ciella was already shaking her head. With a threat to Fallen Reach and her daughter Favela, there was no way Ciella was staying behind.
It's Cal's choice, and at least we know she'll be safe here. There's plenty of food, and we don't have to worry about the enemy, according to Dr. Benza.
So that's it, then, Sina said. We're going. The six, eight of us.
Like Lef said, sooner is better, but we've been pushing hard since the mire. I suggest we take a bit of time to make sure we're rested and ready to go.
Once we're on the road again, who knows the next time we'll be able to let our guard down?
20 hours, I'd say. Any objections or suggestions?
I just want to check one final time,
Wool spoke up.
We're really doing this, leaving Cal behind.
The two sisters exchanged a look, their lips parting like they were each going to say something. Then, as if they had had the same thought at the same time, their mouths tightened and they nodded at each other.
I hate it too, Wool, Sina said. But if this threat to our islands is real, we have to go. We have to try.
We don't even know what the threat is, Nivian pointed out, then sighed and faced his brother. And staying here won't tell us. She's right.
Wu looked in the direction of the dormitory, as if he could see through the walls to Cal in her room. I know she is. It's probably better this way. Cal is safer here than she would be out there. And if she's distracted, then she puts us all at risk. It's the wrong choice for the right reasons. Then it's settled,
Ciela said, her face clearly a mask of forcing a strong front.
20 hours.
I can prep some other food to take with us, Nivian said,
after the weight of the choice settled on the party's shoulders.
The rations are good and all, but there's enough here to add some variety to them. Stuff that'll keep.
Might offer some different buffs as well, depending on the situation,
Yanali said.
Good idea, Sina said. Need any help?
At least 5 sets of eyes widened at Sina's offer, and every head around the table quickly shook.
We want buffs, Sina, Yanali said, not debuffs.
Maybe we should leave Yanali behind after all,
Sina said to her sister.
Tie Cal up instead, drag her along. Could be worth it.
I'm good taking care of the cooking, Nivian said. Could use a few volunteers to maybe test things and see what kind of buffs the food gives, though.
Looks like this, Hiral said, pointing at his dish while he had one eye on his status window. Gives bonuses to endurance and attunement.
Good buff while we're travelling, Wool said. And I can help be a taste tester. We can all help,
Ciela clarified.
Right and left also found out something interesting, Hiral said, when the food conversation seemed finished.
We got currency from the troubling throne. The chips. The currency is called watts,
Left said.
Oh, thanks, Hiral said. Anyway, these watts accumulate as we defeat monsters, absorbing some of the solar energy released. We can in turn spend the currency at the asylum interfaces for equipment.
Left was saying we already have quite a bit from killing the troubling lord several times. And he has some suggestions as far as what we should spend it on.
Left?
The current equipment we can purchase from the interface shop is relatively limited, but there was one very standout item,
Left said.
So standout, in fact, that I almost feel like the PIMP is suggesting we purchase it.
What kind of item? Yanali asked. A weapon?
The item is called an interspatial ring, Left said. According to the description, it's some kind of storage device that contains an instant subspace, similar to a dungeon. It will allow us to carry far more supplies than a normal backpack would, and without all the extra weight. It's simply a ring.
How do you store something in a ring? Sina asked.
I'm not sure on all the details, Left admitted with a shrug. We have enough watts to purchase 6 of the rings, though.
That's oddly convenient, Nivian said.
Which isn't unusual for the PIMP, Hiral said. I'm pretty sure it's doing what it can to tailor our paths towards whatever will make us strongest, without simply gifting us that power.
Says the guy who got an S-rank weapon,
Yanali mumbled.
Which, based on what we learned from Dr. Benza, means he earned it.
Sina said.
If you want an S-rank weapon, I guess that means you'll have to work harder. We all will. Anyway, about the ring. Let's buy one and see how it works. If it's useful, we'll pick up the others. Can we put things like tents in it?
I think so, Left explained.
I did see some limits to what it would hold, and I believe it takes time to deposit or withdraw items, so it may not work well in combat.
Either way, pick one up after we finish here and let us know, Sina said.
Certainly. I'd also like to spend some time doing what I can to reconfirm our route.
Please, Hiral said. I'd hate to get lost along the way.
We should also form a party through the party interface ability. I poked around a bit, and one person has to act as the party leader and invite the other 5.
None of the others spoke up. But they all looked at Sina, then at Ciela, and back to Sina again.
Right.
Sina was the party leader, but Ciela was the, what did they call it?
Raid leader. Go ahead, Ciela said.
This is your party after all.
You sure? Cena asked.
Yeah. Slot me in as a damage dealer, I guess.
Whoa! I thought I was going to be a damage dealer now,
Wool said.
Throwing snowballs doesn't make you a damage dealer,
Yanali said.
Not like we're going to be fighting more lizard men in the next zone anyway.
I think you'll be a good fit to our party,
Cena said, ignoring the others with practiced grace.
Hiral has his RHCs, but with left and right up with Nivian and Yanali, it's getting kind of crowded at the front line. We should probably take a few hours and do some training together before we head out. Get used to the new flow.
I think Yanali needs a couple hours to work on his new move, and I'd like a few to finish what I was doing in the workshop as well,
Hiral said.
Can we meet up after that to practice together?
Knowing you, you'd just be off in your own little world if I asked you to train before you were ready anyway,
Cena said with a smirk.
That works. So here's the plan. A few hours on our own to get ready. A few more after that to smooth out our teamwork. Rest, save, fall and reach. Simple, huh?
I like how you just slid that last bit in there like it was no big thing,
Yanali said.
Yeah, now we just need to figure out what exactly we're saving it from,
Hiral said, putting another spoonful of the stew in his mouth.
Chapter 7 D rank. With everybody finalizing their preparations to go, Hiral did a quick check to make sure he was ready. He had the Emperor's greatsword slung across his back and his RHCs on his thighs. His new and improved RHCs. With the runes of increase and energy, he'd finally found a use for the other two, previously blank, slides in the weapons. The hand cannons now each fired an energy blast that not only scorched what they hit, but also packed at least twice the punch they had before. Definitely a nice upgrade from his class ability to modify crystal gear. Speaking of which, the strange crystal ring floated upright about a foot behind him, so that if he turned his head, he looked right through the open center of it. The script throughout it glowed slightly. And once he had fed it a bit of solar energy, it had instantly moved into position behind him. What it actually did was still the big question, with his view skill giving him nothing but a question mark when he looked at it. There weren't any runes inscribed in the ring to give away its purpose, but when Hiral looked at the space within the ring, there was something like a pull. Solar energy wanted to flow that way, though every time he tried, nothing happened. He was still missing a piece of the puzzle. With a shake of his head, he moved on from his weapons to the ring on his finger. Left's test with the interspatial ring had gone well. So well, in fact, that each of the six people now wore one. Their tents, sleeping bags, food, and other supplies all fit weightlessly inside. It took a few seconds to pull anything out, but it was far more convenient than carrying a backpack around. Hiral even had all his extra crystal in there to work with as they travelled. With his gear in good shape, he pulled open his yellow status window to take a quick look at where he stood, a smile appearing, like it did every time, when his eyes passed over his class. He'd wanted one for so, so many years, it was almost like a dream to actually have it. Not exactly the class he'd always imagined he'd have, but honestly, this runic artificer class was a much better fit for him than Shaper would have been. Eyes travelling down his stats, he noticed he'd even gained another base point of attunement from his time in the workshop. Nice!
Name: Hiral Dorin. Race: Builder. Class: Runic Artificer. Rank: Low D rank, level 1. Attributes: Strength 18.0 equals 18. Endurance 18.0 equals 18. Dexterity 20.32 equals 58. Intelligence 18.0 equals 18. Wisdom
18, 0, equals 18. Attunement, 19, 32, equals 51. Solar energy processing. Absorption rate, S rank. Capacity, S rank. Output rate, S rank. Abilities, runes. Rune of separation, primary. Rune of gravity, secondary. Rune of energy, tertiary. Rune of attraction, forearm, left. Rune of rejection, forearm, right. Rune of absorption, bicep, left. Rune of impact, bicep, right. Rune of decrease, shoulder, left. Rune of increase, shoulder, right. Abilities, active. Foundational split, terminal, eloquent, enraged, intimidate. Abilities, passive. Infernal conjuration, gourmand, racial growth, view enemy health, good things come in threes, walk on water, one man army, plus 20%, internal injuries, D rank, I bow to no one, slight, elemental resistances, 10%, beauty sleep, inspirational growth, party interface, killing spree, life of the party. Racial growth, progress. Troblins, level 5. 4 of 300. Current bonus equals 20%. Giant horned lizards, level 3. 13 of 50. Current bonus equals 10%. Barbed swamp snakes, level 2. 8 of 10. Current bonus equals 5%. Lizardmen, level 4. 58 of 150. Current bonus equals 15%. Hydras, level 1, 1 of 2. Current bonus equals 0%. All in all, Hiral couldn't complain about the progress he'd made since he'd come to the surface. Not only had he finally gotten a class, but also 9 runes, a handful of other active abilities, including foundational split, and a whole slew of passive abilities. It kind of irked him how the PIM used 3 different ways to measure the value of his abilities. Percentage and rank is easy enough, but slightly. What does that even mean? But the fact there was a value at all suggested they were all upgradable. His stats were a little imbalanced, with everything going into dexterity and attunement, but that was what he'd needed to beat the Troblin Lord. And he'd reflexively done the same thing with his first level of D rank points. Still, it was pretty impressive how his dexterity... Hiral paused while he looked at his status window. The math for his dexterity didn't make sense. Since when did 20 plus 32 equal 58? He scratched his head, closed his status window, and then reopened it to see if anything changed. Nope. Still 58. With no obvious answer, Hiral walked up to the asylum interface and waved his hand over the crystal, prompting Dr. Benza to predictably appear. Help, Hiral said, and the doctor's image shifted. Dr. Benza, my status window is saying something strange about my dexterity. The numbers don't add up. Can you explain it?
Accessing PIM, Dr. Benza said. Access complete. Perceived discrepancy likely arises from your high base dexterity, which is naturally in the realm of D rank. For each 10 points of a base attribute beyond the initial 10, a 20% bonus is given to the PIM base stats. This transforms your 32 allocated points into a final result of 38 from your PIM. Ah, wow, Hiral said. So if I get one more point in my attunement, I'll get that 20% bonus there as well? That is correct, Dr. Benza said.
Overpowered,
Yanali said, joining Hiral beside the interface.
Seriously, who did you bribe to get all the good stuff?
says the guy who should be getting 10% to all his stats just for standing beside me, Hiral said. Yanali said, his eyes glazing over as he presumably looked at his status window.
Yeah, that is pretty nice. I thought I felt smarter.
It's all in your head, Left said, joining the two.
No, I'm pretty sure I'm... Ooh,
Yanali said.
Smarter. It's all in my head. I see what you did there.
He winked at Left.
10% on top of a small number is still a small number, Nivian added, coming out of the kitchen.
No need to pick on him, Sina said, coming into the asylum lobby with Wool and Ciela. Guessing everybody is ready?
Yeah, Nivian said. These rings are great. I just tested it, and the stew comes out without spilling. But are we sure about...
I'm sorry, I'm not going with you, Cal's voice said from the living area, and the healer stepped sheepishly into the lobby.
I would just slow you down.
No, you wouldn't, Wool said.
Are you sure?
I am, she said, a bit more strength in her voice.
I can't go back out there yet. It'll be lonely here,
Wool said, worry for his friend, obvious.
Not so lonely, Cal said,
and her fingers tightened around the hand mirror she held at her side. Mirror of memories. Maybe that's what it does. Shows her images of her memories, of the people she's lost. I don't know if that's kind or cruel.
You could, Wool started.
No, Cal said, shaking her head.
Thank you for caring, for worrying about me. But this is my decision. I'm staying. You need to go, though. Favela needs you.
As she said this, she looked at Ciela. From the glance that passed between them, this wasn't the first time they'd had the conversation.
I understand, Wool said. We'll miss you, and we'll come pick you up when the city comes around again. You better be ready.
I will.
You can use the globe Dr. Benzi creates to monitor the island's progress,
Left said.
Yes. I'll be waiting for you all, Cal said, forcing herself to smile. Stay safe, please. I don't want to see you in...
She cut off, her eyes darting down to her hand.
I don't want to see you hurt, she amended. Come back safe.
I'll make sure of it this time, Nivian said. No matter what it takes, I won't let anything happen to them.
I know you won't,
Cal said, looking at each of the party members. Then she abruptly turned and vanished back into the living area. The soft click of a distant door closing told them all where she'd gone.
Is she really going to be okay? Wool asked.
We have to trust she'll be, Sina said. We've got enough on our plates now.
Left, you know where we're going?
Sort of, the double said with a shrug. There should be a disk of passage waiting for us back where we first arrived to take us to the next zone. But there's no data on what we'll find in the zone itself.
I spoke with Wool, and he confirmed the area is too far away from the Ensath River for him to have any information on it.
So we're going in blind? Yanali asked.
Nothing different from the dungeons, Hiral said. We've got this.
He's right. We do, Sina said.
Recap, in case anybody, she looked specifically at Yanali, wasn't listening before.
We're going to this D-rank zone to clear the three dungeons and get to the next asylum as quickly as possible. No farming for experience there. Once we're through to the zone after that, also D-rank, we'll either move right to the jump point or start clearing dungeons there. All depends on time. Our secondary goal is, of course, to try and get a class evolution for at least one of us. If we can do that, Dr. Benzer will hopefully give us some information on the threats to Fallen Reach and our islands. If we can't,
and we get to the second zone with time to spare. Hiral, I want to try to use that rest bonus ability you got to get you to C rank. It's a long shot, to say the least, but it's the best backup plan I could come up with.
Hiral nodded. I did some testing with Beauty Sleep when we were looping in the Troublin Throne. Seems I need 2 hours of good rest, which is kind of subjective if you ask me, to get 1 hour of bonus experience. However, if we can find a good farm spot with constant enemies, between that and killing spree, I could see the experience really racking up.
Overpowered, Yanali mumbled predictably. Can't argue with you this time, given the right circumstances, Hiral said. The bonus won't amount to much while we're travelling, but if we find a spot to set up camp and hunt from there, it could be impressive.
Hopefully we won't need to get you to C rank, but it's good to have the option, Sina said. One last thing. The enemy.
As soon as she said the words, a tension ran through Hiral's shoulders, along with the mental image of a glowing grin. That thing that had taken over Piccoli was still out there, but it was way back where they'd started. In a few hours, they'd be thousands of miles away from it. No, it was a problem to deal with, maybe, when they came back for Cal. The bigger question was whether or not there were more of them out there.
By the looks on your faces, I can see you're all thinking the same thing I am, Sina said. We still know next to nothing about this so-called enemy. Not what they look like, or what they want.
They can fly, they're invisible, and they really want us dead, Yanali said. I think that honestly sums up all the important stuff.
They can also infest or possess people, or something like that, Hiral said. And they can use the same runes I do.
Yes, Sina said. They're dangerous. But it also seems like they only come out when the rain is the worst. We move when it's light. We hide when it's heavy. As long as we're careful, we should be able to avoid them.
Any chance there are more like Piccoli? Wool asked.
Sina shrugged.
From the map, the zone we're going to isn't close to the river, which should also mean none of our people would have been lost there. I think the odds of it are low, but we'll keep an eye out.
Even if we do run into one, we're all D rank now, with new equipment and abilities, Nivian said. We can do this.
We can, Sina agreed. Let's go.
Chapter 8.
Wild Dungeon. Almost 2 hours later, Hiral sat with the others on a disc of passage as it raced down a seemingly endless hall. They'd found it waiting for them in one of the two previously empty spots where they'd first arrived, and a quick swipe over the activation crystal had sent them on their way. Nobody really said much, each person keeping to themselves, which was mostly fine for Hiral. It gave him time to tinker until Sina left her sister's side.
What you got there?
Sina said, breaking the silence. Hiral made a fist with his left hand and held it up, the crystal wrapped around his knuckles.
It's for Wright, a rune of impact, so he isn't always relying on one hand. I wanted to make them for his knees and feet too, but... What happens when he vanishes?
Sina asked, eyeing the crystal knuckles. Hiral chuckled.
Exactly. This drops to the ground? They're pretty easy to make, so I've got a couple for him. One isn't a huge investment, but losing a whole set each time? That'd add up fast. Going to see how one works, then maybe I'll figure something else out later.
Won't he get more options as you unlock your runes? Sina asked.
There's that, too, though he'll never get anything on his left side, Hiral said, pointing at the doubles, meridian, and tattoo bear side.
Yeah, Sina said, then shook her head. Your foundational split ability has got to be the strangest thing I've ever seen. left and right are so much more than what I feel like an ability should be able to do. They're so real.
They are, Hiral agreed. And more than that, they're friends.
Is it strange I'm friends with myself?
Yes, but I've been listening to you talk to yourself for quite a while now, so I'm used to it.
Thanks, I think. Hiral stowed the crystal knuckles away for the moment and pulled out another foot-long bar of crystal, about an inch wide. Anyway, I've got something else I think you'll like, even more than the knuckles.
A ruler? Sina asked, looking at the crystal.
Exactly. You know how I feel about measurements and testing. This will make it much easier to...
He trailed off when Sina scowled at him, then just chuckled.
I'm kidding. I mean, we could use it as a ruler if we needed to draw a straight line. Okay, I'm sorry. I'll stop. It's to keep the rain off us.
What? Really? She asked, the scowl vanishing instantly.
Yep. I just need to wrap this bar around your upper arm. Then, when you thread some solar energy into it, it'll activate the rune of rejection. See? Right here. He pointed at the rune.
Have you tested it yet? Sina asked, leaning in closer.
Not yet. I just finished the set.
Sina slowly but deliberately leaned back. I heard about Yanali and his boots.
So? Hiral asked, trying to keep his face neutral.
This thing isn't going to reject our arms off or something, is it?
Wool can't fix that, I don't think.
Sina looked over towards where the healer was talking to his twin.
Hey, Wool, can you regrow limbs yet?
He can't even regrow facial hair, Nivian answered for Wool.
Wool scowled at his brother, then looked at Sina.
No? Why?
Sina looked at Hiral, then whispered out of the corner of her mouth.
Let's test it on Nivian first.
Not Yanali, Hiral asked.
Both at the same time?
Sina offered as a compromise.
I've got two.
Perfect. But seriously, if it rejects their arms off, I'll be annoyed. A sleeve is okay. Maybe a finger.
It won't reject any limbs off, Hiral said. I promise. It's not nearly powerful enough for that. All it'll do is reject most of the rain about an inch away from the body. If the rain is really heavy, some will probably still get through, though.
Keeping any of it off us will be...
Sina started, but left interrupted.
We're slowing down.
Oh, we're there already? Hiral said, standing up and looking down the tunnel.
It still continued on for quite the distance, the glowing roots extending ahead on both sides.
I believe it's too early, Left said, unless my calculations were off before we left. Hiral has a new ruler you can use next time,
Sina said, elbowing Hiral in the side.
You're very funny, he deadpanned, but they walked up to join Left, along with everybody else, as the disc noticeably slowed.
There's something ahead of us, I think, Hiral said, a shape in the tunnel resolving in the darkness, as the disc further slowed and finally came to a complete stop.
Damn, Nivian cursed, and Hiral couldn't disagree.
The entire tunnel ahead had collapsed, thousands and thousands of tons of solid rock now completely blocking their way.
Dr. Benz's map didn't have anything about this,
Wu asked, turning to Left.
Nothing, the double said. Can we dig through it? Yanali offered. How far are we from our destination?
At least 100 miles minimum, Left said. And as for digging... He just shook his head.
It was a fair question, but looking at the rock, Hiral had to agree with his double's assessment. That wasn't just a minor cave-in. No, the smallest rock was bigger than Hiral, while he couldn't even make out the ends of some of the larger ones.
We're not getting through that, Hiral said. Back to the asylum, then. See if we can find another route
that'll let us get ahead of Fallen Reach.
Do we have time for that?
Cena asked. Don't see how we have a choice, Hiro responded with a shrug. But before anybody else could speak up, a portal spiraled open at the end of the disc, closest to the tunnel collapse.
What's that? Yanali asked,
and an appropriately timed notification window appeared in front of Hiral to answer the question. Congratulations, you have discovered a wild dungeon, the Buried City. Dynamic quest. Complete the wild dungeon, the Buried City, to gain passage to the other side. Note, wild dungeons are rare instances containing powerful lost equipment and unique quests. Note 2. Wild dungeons appear randomly and may only be completed once. Note 3. Wild dungeons do not usually count towards asylum access.
That's interesting, Hiral said, quickly reading the notification window a second time before minimizing it. Everybody got that bit about a wild dungeon?
Powerful lost equipment, Yanali said. Count me in.
It seems oddly convenient we found this wild dungeon here, Ciela said. Do you think it will really take us to the other side of the cave-in?
Technically, it doesn't say the other side of what, Left pointed out. It could just be the other side of the city.
Even if it does take us to the other side of the collapse, is it going to take the disc as well?
Wu asked.
Or is it just going to portal us out over empty air?
He peered over the side of the disc and into the darkness below.
Dr. Benza may be a bit of a sadist, but I don't think even he would do that, Hiral said. Again, the point of the dungeons is to make us stronger, not to kill us unfairly.
You think we should go in?
Cena asked him, then looked at the portal. Hiral considered it for a moment, but there wasn't really much to think about, so he nodded. I do. Going back, we might find another path. On the other hand, this wild dungeon could be an opportunity to get an advanced class.
And powerful lost equipment, Yanali reminded them, again.
Cena ignored the spearman, turning to the portal and tapping her chin in thought. Going in was a risk, like any dungeon, and possibly also a waste of time if it didn't actually get them past the collapse. Worst case scenario, we lose 3 hours while we're in there, Hiral said.
No, worst case is we'll die horribly,
Wool pointed out.
I won't let that happen,
Nivian said, his tone cutting the joke off right there.
I won't.
There's no guarantee there's another route available to us, Left said. The number of D-rank zones connected to the first asylum was quite limited. Okay, we're going in.
Cena then seemed to remember Ciela was there and looked over at her.
Sis?
Ciela said, her attention firmly on the portal until Cena called her name. She shook off whatever had distracted her.
Oh, I think it's the right call. Since we don't know how long the portal will stay open, or how to reopen it if it closes, I suggest we head in soon.
Wool, give us buffs, both of them, Cena said.
We don't know if we have the same waiting lobby the other dungeons had.
She then quickly cast Lashing Vines on the party. Hiral reflexively glanced at the thorny vines wreathed in purple flames that grew painlessly from his shoulders. You have been buffed by Lashing Vines. Vines will make independent attacks to enemies within range for 21 minutes.
Still pretty creepy, he said.
Oh, duration went way up.
Yeah, a minute per level now that it's D rank,
Cena said. Nice. Hiral said, then felt two pulses of solar energy, along with a pair of notifications. You have been buffed by Nature's Bulwark. Reduces damage taken by 10% for 210 minutes. You have been buffed by Nature's Blade. Increases damage inflicted by 10% for 21 minutes. Blade got a duration increase, but Bulwark didn't, he asked Wool.
I haven't gotten Nature's Bulwark to D rank yet, Wool said with a shrug,
his pair of lantern-like solar batteries now floating behind him.
Don't use it as much as Nature's Blade because of its longer base duration.
Why not cast it again as soon as it fades, even if we're not expecting to fight? Hiral asked, while everybody else made sure they were ready to go.
That's actually a good idea. Before we started running dungeons, I figured it'd be another full rotation at least before I got to D rank.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.